This is the Bookwaves Artwaves Hour. Interviews with writers on KPFA's nationally syndicated Bookwaves program, along with interviews about film and theater and archive book interviews that stretch back four decades. I'm your host, Richard Wolinsky. Today's program opens with an interview with Bonnie Tsui, whose book, Why We Swim, is now out in trade paperback. It's particularly timely now as people start going back to the beaches and into municipal pools. The interview was recorded a year ago during the height of the shutdown, and I was still learning the rudiments of home recording. That's followed by a 2016 interview with Jim Obergefell, whose name appears in Obergefell versus Hodges, the landmark 2015 Supreme Court ruling which made gay marriage legal across the United States. In his book, which he co-wrote, Love Wins, he details his own story and the larger story of the lawsuit that changed life in America for the LBG community. As usual, links to various theater and bookstore venues can be found by going to the webpage of today's program at kpfa.org. Now on to the first interview of the show. My guest is Bonnie Tsui, whose latest book is Why We Swim. She's also the author of American Chinatown, A People's History of Five Neighborhoods, editor of A Leaky Tent is a Piece of Paradise, and there's also a history of women in the Civil War. Bonnie Tsui also writes for the New York Times Magazine, San Francisco Chronicle, The Atlantic, Wired, several other publications, and she is a swimmer. This is the first book in 10 years. What made you think about writing a book about kind of the history of swimming?
I wanted to write a book about swimming because I realized that it's played such a big role in my life and a background role for a long time. But then sort of lately, it's become to the forefront as just something that I realize is something that I need every day. You know, it's like the daily tonic of getting in the water and finding some meditation and peace and exercise and immersion in this pretty noisy world of ours. And my parents, you know, they met in a swimming pool in Hong Kong. My dad was a lifeguard, and then my brother and I consequently joined the swim team, became lifeguards ourselves. And we just kind of had a, you know, our family history is around water, growing up on Long Island in New York and on the beaches there, Jones Beach and the public pools and swim teams there. You know, over the years, having swimming be this, you know, this essential thing that I used to keep sane. And I kind of wanted to investigate how, you know, there's so many books about running, right? So wait, there are so many of us recognize running as a thing that keeps us sane. And for me, it's not on land, it's in water. And I wanted to write a book that honored that for us swimmers out there.
When you first began, I mean, had there been essays that you'd written about swimming that you could kind of go back to and, you know, kind of examine, okay, this is what I have. Where do I need to go from here?
Yeah, you know, I noticed that over the years, you know, so I've been a journalist, a freelance journalist for many years now. And I would, every once in a while, I would write a piece about swimming, you know, whether it was a favorite lake. My husband and I, our special place is Lake George. It's a place that we got married, and it was a place that is strong in his family history, with his grandparents meeting and getting married there, and then his parents meeting and getting married there, and then us spending a lot of time early in our relationship. So, you know, I noticed that every time I'd write a piece that was, you know, an homage to a place or an homage to swimming as, you know, something that is really special to me, I would get these wonderful letters from people. And I realized that, you know, this is something that people wanted to get more of. And I thought, okay, so maybe there is an audience for the swimming book. And how can I make that, you know, something different from what the world has seen?
In that regard, at what point did you start? Did you start with Iceland? Did you start with a history of swimming? I'm talking about how you researched before you even sat down and wrote anything.
Right. Yeah. You know, I thought about this book for years and years. So I wrote a piece about 6 years ago for the New York Times Sunday Review, and it was about how swimming is the last refuge from connectivity. You know, that was the piece that kind of kicked this whole thing off, because I got such an avalanche of mail about it that I thought, what structure should it take? How can I present this that it you know, like I said, in a way that's different. And I started collecting all these stories. People started telling me stories about, you know, survival stories and just like extraordinary swim stories of people who swim in crazy places, but also these very personal histories. And I realized that I wanted to have a way to include all of those things. And so I started collecting all these stories and just really interesting bits of history. So really it was, you know, a few years of just kind of putting these things into a file and kind of every once in a while looking at it and maybe jotting down a few notes or writing a little bit of it. And then, you know, I started to show it to friends I trusted to kind of inquire about how can we present this in a way that makes sense. It's not just a big mess about, you know, the idea of swimming. I settled upon this question of why we swim. Why we swim is the title of the book. And the way the book is structured is five different ways we can answer that question. It starts with survival and then runs through, you know, health and community, competition, and flow.
And that's why you didn't cover certain areas like scuba, for instance, or snorkeling, or even water sports like water skiing, because it didn't fit within those that structure.
Yeah, you know, and those things are certainly related. Swimming plays such a supporting role in so many sports, so many water sports. But, you know, I wanted to focus on the thing itself.
You go into a history of swimming, and that seems to go back, well, to Roman times, but also perhaps to a lake in the Sahara.
Yeah. The thing that I kind of mentioned in the book is that the problem with a wake is that it disappears, right? So trying to track human history with swimming in the water is, you know, it doesn't stick around. And so I had to come at this from an oblique angle. I like to think about it that way, because what is the first evidence really of human swimming? And earliest record of people swimming is cave paintings in the middle of the Sahara. And so it's called the Cave of Swimmers, and it's these drawings of people breaststroking up the walls of a cave. And they're dated as far back as 10,000 years ago. And they were discovered by this Hungarian explorer named Laszlo Almasy. You know, he had speculated at the time that possibly there were swimmers and there was a body of water nearby when those pictures were made. And of course, at the time, he was laughed, you know, out of the room, a kook. And it turns out, of course, that over the many decades since, that there's plenty of evidence of climate change. And the time, the period this happened was when the Sahara was green. And so it's what scientists refer to as the Green Sahara. There were lakes, there were, you know, people migrating around from lake to lake, paleo lakes, they call them, and, you know, making a life along the shores of a lot of water bodies in what is now the desert.
And then, of course, the Romans, and over on the other side of the world, the Japanese used swimming as part of military exercises.
Swimming, of course, lends itself to being a martial art, you know, something that supports the conquering of peoples and lands all over the place and has been, you know, since time immemorial. And so, you know, there is a lot of interesting cultural history around the world pointing to the evidence of these stories of where swimming and good water skills were helpful in, you know, the conquering of lands.
I noticed, Bonnie Tsui, that as you talk about swimming in the book, a lot of things come up that we don't think about. For instance, the way I learned to swim is we had a boat in Long Island Sound, a 33-foot cabin cruiser. And every year from when I was a little kid, my father would wrap a rope around me and put me in the water. And if I went down, that wasn't the year. And one year I stayed up. But I learned how to dog paddle. And what I found in your book is that strokes, dog paddles, crawl, these are recent inventions.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the sort of standardization of the strokes to the four competition strokes, as we know them, right, butterfly, backstroke, breaststroke, and freestyle, are relatively recent inventions. We have, as humans, as a species, been able to swim for many thousands of years, and who knows what kinds of strokes we were using to convey ourselves across the water. But it is interesting to see how instinctively, when we are first learning how to swim, how we tend to, you know, doggy paddle or do like a sort of breaststroke kick. Young kids, when they're learning how to swim, you know, their natural inclination is not to be doing what we know now as freestyle, you know, crawl stroke. And it points back to the fact that we have to be taught how to swim. We have to learn how to swim. We're not instinctive swimmers from birth the way most terrestrial mammals are. And so I find that so fascinating that we come from the water way back when in our evolutionary past, and we're certainly birthed from water, you know, from the womb, but that we have to relearn how to survive and conduct ourselves in the water. That's something so unique to us as a species, is that we pass along that cultural knowledge from one generation to the next. And those stories are how we make meaning and talk about the importance of how to survive in the water. And swimming is one of those skills.
What I found from having stayed up by dog paddles is that whenever I went in the water, something in me changed. And that's another part of your book. Swimming is meditation.
What was so wonderful about researching this book is finding out all the ways that we respond psychologically, physiologically to the water, that our brains respond to water in certain ways, that we're wired to do so, that our alpha wave activity goes up. You know, those are the brainwaves that are associated with relaxation and calm and creativity. And that the sound of water, the sight of water, and then immersion does something to our bodies, you know, that we have like these mammalian reflexes, dive reflexes, you know, once we immerse ourselves in water. And that's something that we can't really control, you know, that we're attracted and pulled to the water in ways that we are only just beginning to understand.
During this pandemic, have you been in the water in San Francisco Bay?
I have. You know, we're lucky enough here in Northern California to still be able to get in the water into the bay. And so I've been swimming in the bay a few times a week and, you know, getting out to surf in the Pacific when the conditions are right. And so I feel like even though it's not the same routine that I'm used to, you know, my normal routine is to get into the Albany pool in the mornings, you know, several times a week, 4 days a week usually, and kind of filling out the rest, surfing or swimming in open water. And I just feel very fortunate that I can still get into the water, but it's a different thing. It's a different thing to be in open water than it is to be in a pool. You have to be so much more present. You have to be attentive to the dangers and the risks in those waters. And so that's also part of like what I explore in the book, which is this tension between, you know, swimming and drowning and life and death, that I think is really a unique one to the sport, that we're always kind of aware that we don't quite belong, but we want to belong.
The bay is very cold though.
Yeah, well, it's all relative, right? Actually, lately it's been like, you know, 60 or so, which is balmy for here. It's a weird time for us. It's a weird time for trying to figure out how to get in waters around us safely. It's, you know, it's getting on summer and people are really desperate to jump in somewhere, you know, all across, you know, the country and around the world is just something that we all, again, are craving. And so it's a weird time, certainly, to try to manage all of these desires.
What brought you to writing about swimming in the green zone in Baghdad about 10 years ago?
That's a great story. Actually, that story came to me via a pen pal of mine. So Jay Taylor is the central character in this particular story in this section of the book. And he was a lifelong Foreign Service guy, been posted all around the world. And he found himself in Baghdad in 2008 in a posting there to try to restart the Fulbright program, the cultural exchange program with Iraqis. And, you know, it was a time of pretty heavy combat and it was, you know, very much a war zone. And so at the time, the green zone was around Saddam Hussein's Republican Palace. And so Saddam Hussein and his sons apparently really liked swimming and had pools at all of their palaces around the country. And this pool at the Republican Palace was this palatial, crazy, baroque, like lots of diving boards, fountains, but it was something that was available to people who were stationed in Baghdad to use in the green zone. And so he started to swim in this pool. And then over time, you know, there were UN peacekeepers, translators, local Iraqis who were working with the Americans, other folks from around the world. It was like a United Nations, a mini United Nations of people who started to approach Jay and ask him to teach them, you know, give him a few pointers on swimming. And he ended up over the next 2 years having a roster of like 250 people who would come for lessons. And then they moved, you know, the green zone moved from the Republican Palace to a more fortified structure that had a 25-yard pool. And it was this very, very strange and unique situation where it was a place where in the middle of a war zone that there was community and solace to be found in this pool. And it was a really amazing story to me. And I wanted to share that in the book as an example of how we find our tribe in all kinds of ways, and that in this particular singular moment in Baghdad, that it was a place for people of all different backgrounds and situations to come together and, you know, find peace. And I think about water as the great equalizer when we have access and education to it, to swimming, that it is something that we all should be able to do and have the opportunity to experience.
You're listening to an interview with Bonnie Tsui about her book, Why We Swim. I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves Artswaves Hour.
You spend a lot of time talking about a woman named Kim Chambers. Did she contact you?
I was actually introduced to her by a mutual friend of ours, Adam Skolnick, who is another water baby, so to speak. He wrote a book about freediving. He said, you got to meet Kim. I know you're working on this book, thinking about this book on swimming. Kim is this legendary marathon swimmer by now. She has an incredible story, and her story anchors the well-being section of the book because she only really came to swimming as an adult after she almost lost her leg to amputation after an accident where she fell down the stairs of her apartment here in San Francisco. And she started to swim as part of her rehab and then discovered through joining the Dolphin Club here in the Bay Area. Dolphin Club, for all of you who don't know, is one of the premier open water swimming clubs in the world and has been around since, you know, the 1800s. And people swim in the bay and they learn how to conduct themselves safely. And she started to swim with the dolphins, also joined the South End Rowing Club, which is right next door, and found this community that helped her, I guess, have a new life, you know, have this incredible new life as someone who has swum from the Farallons to San Francisco. She was the first woman to do so. You know, she has done all kinds of other incredible open water swimming feats and continues to do that. And her story is one that I found so inspiring. And, you know, there's been a documentary made about her journey. It's called Kim Swims, and I encourage you all to check it out.
I can't even pronounce the name of the Icelandic guy, the Icelandic hero. How do you pronounce his name?
Gunnlaugr Friðþórsson.
That got you over to Iceland, and it turns out that some people, their bodies are suited to the water.
I mean, his story is really extraordinary. He is an Icelandic fisherman who, in 1984, his fishing vessel capsized off the coast of Iceland, and he had to swim 6 hours to shore in 41 degree water. And, you know, for most of us, within 20 to 30 minutes, we would die from hypothermia and exposure. But he was able to keep swimming. And when he finally got to the hospital, he did not show any signs of hypothermia and was only a little bit dehydrated. And how that was possible was that, A, he was a great swimmer. B, his body fat resembled that of a seal's. You know, it was 2 to 3 times normal human thickness and more solid, and it was able to keep his core stable, his core temperature stable, and him safe as he kept swimming. And he was the first person I ever documented to have this biological quirk. He participated in studies, medical studies, to kind of, you know, research into human endurance and response to hypothermia. I mean, it was this very tragic thing that happened to him, but then he's this Icelandic hero. You know, what he was able to do is something that looms large in Icelandic culture, even today. I mean, every year there's a swim done in his honor, 6 kilometers swim, and I went to Iceland to do that swim and to meet him.
In the book, there's a lot of information What surprised you, shocked you the most in your research? Something that you thought, oh my God, really?
That's a really great question. One of the things that I was really surprised to learn is that we are born with two kinds of fat. Okay, so part of this whole cold water survival immersion thing, you know, I really wanted to learn about science and what makes some of us seem to be able to withstand cold water immersion more than others. And then I learned about something called brown fat. So we, you know, mammals are born with two kinds of fat. So white fat, which is what we all know to be our energy stores, right? Stores energy, keeps us warm. And brown fat is a different kind of fat that instead of storing energy, it burns it. It creates heat energy. And so, you know, we're born with only a certain amount of it, and then it starts to kind of disappear as we get older. Babies have a lot of brown fat. They don't have enough muscle tone to shiver when they're cold to keep warm, and so their brown fat keeps them warm. What I found was that over the course of your lifetime, you can sort of brown white fat in different ways with exercise, and cold exposure is one of the ways to do it. There's also a really interesting research into how capsaicin, you know, in what's in like sort of spicy pepper, cayenne pepper, can actually also brown white fat and turn it into what's called beige fat. And so it's just like a really interesting rabbit hole to dive down into how our bodies have strange ways of adapting and responding to the environment. And so that is a really interesting section of the book about health and, you know, what we always have seen to be as like the water cure. There's some like basis in like why the water feels so good to us, and also that it has health benefits that are interesting to explore. And I just really loved getting a little bit into the nitty-gritty of that.
Bonnie Tsui, you were born in Queens. Did you live as a little kid in Flushing?
I was born in Flushing, and then we moved when I was school age to Long Island. That's sort of where I went to school. But my family was all in scattered through like Queens and New York Chinatown. That's sort of the doorway of my family into America.
What prompted you to become a writer? I mean, had you always been writing as a kid?
I did. You know, I always dreamed of stories. I would make little books of stories and with drawings. My dad is an artist, and so I grew up in his studio, downstairs studio. And so we were immersed in this like pretty creative life. And so I knew I wanted to be either an artist, a visual artist, or a writer. And that kind of like shook out in college, where I discovered the joys of like creative nonfiction. I realized that like nonfiction journalism could be, you could apply some of the same creative techniques of fiction to tell a really great true story and to animate that story and give it power. And so I think that's something that I've always tried really hard to do in my journalism.
Was it Hunter Thompson? Was it Truman Capote?
I'm not a gonzo journalist. I am, however, a participatory journalist, I would say. And I think that this book certainly reflects that.
What books did you read that put you on that course?
I had a really wonderful instructor in college named Natalie Kush, and she wrote this memoir called Road Song, and it was about growing up in Alaska. And she was just this really wonderful teacher in story. Everything that we read in that class was true. But, you know, the lens through which you told a story could change the way the reader interpreted it. And that was a really interesting lesson in perspective and point of view, and just how you can weight certain aspects of a story to give it power, to give it resonance, to make it connect to a reader.
Your first book was this history of women in the Civil War?
Yes, I was at the time a young reporter toiling at Advertising Age, which is the trade magazine of the advertising world and business. It was my first real writing job. I had worked at an adventure travel magazine before that, but it was my first like full-time like reporting job, and I was learning how to, you know, cover media and all that. And I was looking for the creative outlet. And I had written this paper in college on women soldiers in the Civil War and just loved that topic and that experience of doing that, digging the archives, and I was studying under just amazing historians. And I dug it out, and I knew that there was a small historical press looking for new books. And I wrote a book about women soldiers in the Civil War called She Went to the Field.
Well, it sounds like your second book was a little bit more to your liking. American Chinatown, A People's History of Five Neighborhoods, that's in five major cities. Did you figure this book hasn't been written and I need to write it?
That's exactly right. I wanted to write a book about these neighborhoods, but also about the idea of the neighborhood in the American imagination and how the sort of story and mythology around Chinatowns in the United States contrasted against the reality of the lived experience of different generations of Chinese and Chinese Americans in those neighborhoods. And again, like I mentioned before, my family history came through, both my father and my mother's families came through New York and San Francisco's Chinatowns. And I wanted to talk about, you know, three different generations in each neighborhood. So New York Chinatowns, San Francisco Chinatown, and then also Los Angeles, Honolulu, and Las Vegas Chinatown as the sort of like a new model of what a Chinatown was, like how that it didn't grow from the sort of residential community. It was sort of built as a business, and then the residential community sprang up around it. And so I had a wonderful time writing about this because it gave me a reason to investigate my own family history, you know, and hear stories from my grandparents and from my parents and other relatives and other people in the community. They don't get to share that story and tell it very often. And so it was something that I wanted to do them the honor of doing.
Bonnie Tsui, your most recent pieces, there's an article very recently in San Francisco Chronicle about attacks on Asians due to the xenophobia coming out of Washington. And this is continuing now. There was actually something I was just turning on television just before we got on here. Increase of attacks on Asian Americans, like up 20%. Do you see a trend here, or is this something that has to do with, again, the monsters coming out of Washington?
The increase in xenophobia and negative feeling towards and racism towards Asian Americans specifically, but just towards all people of color, immigrants, people who are perceived as other, perceived as immigrants. I think that this recent uptick in that happening does have a specific relationship to the pandemic and the political reality of our country today. But I also feel like it is exposing what has always been there in sort of the history of this country and has sort of lain dormant for a while. It is useful to remember that in the history of America, that it's a country of immigrants, and yet every successive wave of immigrants has experienced this vitriolic xenophobia, violence, racism, and that it is a story that is really as old as this country, and it continues today. And so we have to reckon with that, and we can't really make it go away until we really face that in a very specific and obvious way.
You've been listening to an interview with Bonnie Tsui about her book, Why We Swim. I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves Artwaves Hour. We'll be right back. Coming up now, the second interview of the day. In June 2015, the Supreme Court decided in Obergefell versus Hodges that gay marriage would become the law of the land. In the 6 years that followed, gay marriage has been routinely accepted across the United States, and few blink twice when someone mentions his husband or her wife. I interviewed Jim Obergefell, the man whose name appears on the decision, a year after that decision, while he was on tour for the book Love Wins.
My guest is Jim Obergefell,
who is the co-author of Love Wins, The Lovers and Lawyers Who Fought the Landmark Case for Marriage Equality, co-written by Debbie Cenziper, who won the Pulitzer Prize with the Miami Herald. Since Obergefell, which was the groundbreaking gay marriage decision in the Supreme Court, Jim Obergefell has been a spokesperson going around the country talking about gay issues, gay rights. Let's talk about Love Wins. And of course, this refers back to your own life and your marriage to John Arthur. As he was dying, you wanted to make sure his death certificate listed you as a husband. But in Ohio, even though you were married in Maryland, in Ohio, you could not be listed as the husband. And that started the ball rolling, which eventually led to the Supreme Court decision of a year ago. Where does Debbie Cenziper come in, and how did this book originate?
Over the 2 years of the case, a lot of people kept saying, hey, Jim, you should write a book about this. Write a book. And for the first year, bit more than a year of the case, that wasn't something I could really seriously consider because I was still too deep in my grief. I needed to deal with that, work through that first. In April of last year, April of 2015, I got a phone call from Debbie. And she said, Jim, I have a literary agent who's been pushing me to write a book. And I kept telling her I wouldn't do it until it was something I was passionate about.
Had you met her before?
Debbie's first husband was John's first cousin, or is John's first cousin. So I've known her for 25 years. That gave me a sense of safety, a sense of comfort. After I said, yes, let's do this, the very next day she took a leave of absence from the Washington Post. And we started working on the book proposal.
What happened then?
We wanted to have the proposal ready to go out on decision day, whenever decision day happened to occur. So we got right to work. And as you can imagine, I was fairly busy at that point because the oral arguments had either just happened or were getting ready to happen. And then with the wait for the decision, I was incredibly busy. So Debbie really dove in and she started doing research. She started doing interviews. She started doing some writing. And we had it ready by mid-June. Like so many other people, we thought, well, this is a major decision, likely won't come out until later in June, but we wanted to make sure it was ready in case it came out mid-June. So on decision day, within 30 minutes, our literary agent sent the proposal out.
On the writing itself, you worked on the writing too.
I was involved in the writing, yes. She would start with something, provide it to me, I would make changes, I would make edits, I would add stuff, I would write some, and it was that constant back and forth. And with the short time frame we had, I was relying on Debbie's skill as a journalist who works under deadline. So that was one of the helpful things in that she is really good at working very fast and working to a deadline.
Jim Obergefell, John died from ALS.
Correct.
And you were approached by Al Gerhardstein just a few weeks before he passed away.
A couple months. We got married on Thursday, July 11th, 2013. And a story about us and our effort and what we went through to get married was in our local paper that weekend. And friends of ours were at a party and they ran into Al, who's a friend of theirs, Al Gerhardstein. And our story came up in conversation. And John and I had no plans to do anything. We simply wanted to get married. We wanted to live out John's remaining days as husband and husband. No plans, no thoughts, no imaginings of a lawsuit. But Al, as he listened to our friends Barb and Mike, his gears are turning, and he asked them if he thought we might be willing to talk to him. We got married on Thursday. That conversation happened on Saturday. Al came over for the first time on Tuesday. And it was that conversation, the first time we met Al, where he did something that changed the course of our lives and helped bring us closer to marriage equality. And that was he pulled out a blank death certificate.
When Debbie did her research on Al, had you known all of that background, his relationship as a civil rights attorney?
I knew some of that. I knew he was a local civil rights attorney, but I really didn't know the extent of his dedication and his fight towards civil rights, and especially towards the LGBTQ community. You know, he worked for 5 years pro bono fighting an amendment to the city charter of Cincinnati that said no laws could be passed to protect the LGBT community. And there's a family connection. One of his brothers is gay. So I knew some of that, but not all of it. And I learned so much more about Al and just gained a much greater respect for him.
Let me ask you this. A year has passed. Has he seen any money from this case?
Yes. And I won't remember exactly when this happened, but Al and all of the attorneys involved in this case from the four states, you know, they got the ruling that they are due payment from the individual states, and I know that has happened.
Love wins is two stories at once. It's kind of a love story between you guys, and it's also kind of a thriller. If you don't know the ending, it's probably a little better, but even if you do know the ending. But of course, it goes back to your relationship. During that period, you were together almost 21 years. How did John view gay rights? How did you view it during those years?
You know, the funny thing is, and I think in some ways it's surprising that I can say this, that wasn't really a topic of conversation for us much over our years together. You know, John and I never hid who we are. From the moment we became a couple in Cincinnati, in a very gay-unfriendly city, and we worked together four different jobs, every employer, every coworker, every client, everyone in our lives knew we were a couple. Now, we weren't the couple that walked down the street holding hands. Even if we had been in an incredibly gay-friendly area, that just wasn't John. He wouldn't have done that regardless.
Would you?
I would have, yeah, absolutely. But I was always more effusive, more emotional. John was much more of the logic-based person in our relationship. I was all about feelings. So absolutely, I would have done that if he were willing. But I knew better than to push it because it wasn't who he was and he wouldn't have been comfortable. So we never hid who we were. And over our almost 21 years together, we absolutely talked about marriage many times. But for us, we didn't want to get married unless it actually carried legal weight. We didn't want to do it just to have it be symbolic. And in 1992-93, when this ballot issue was in Cincinnati to enact that charter amendment that banned protections for the gay community, we absolutely felt a level of unease in our city. We were surrounded by people, family and friends who loved us, considered us a married couple. So there wasn't anything specific directed toward us. It was just that general level of our neighbors, our fellow Cincinnatians don't like us. But it wasn't really a topic of conversation for us. We just lived our lives. We surrounded ourselves with people we loved and who loved us, and we made the best of it.
And so there was never any discussion about Harvey Milk or about the AIDS crisis, which at that point was coming to a, quote, end?
I mean, there certainly was some because, you know, we were of the generation where it was coming to an end, and we certainly were impacted by it personally, friends, but not nearly to the extent of people older than we are. John preferred to talk about happy things. He preferred to spend his energy talking about things that made him feel good, made other people feel good, as opposed to talking about things that weren't so happy.
And in the days later, 2013 was it, I guess, when he was dying?
He was diagnosed in 2011, in June of 2011, and by March or April of 2013, by that point, he started an at-home hospice care program.
When you learned that you would not be on the death certificate, when you found out and told John, what was his reaction?
Well, we found out together. 5 days after we got married, Al Gerhardstein came to our home. He pulled out a blank death certificate. And he said, now, guys, I'm sure you haven't thought about this because who thinks about a death certificate when you've just gotten married? But do you understand that when John dies, his last official record as a person will be wrong? Ohio will say he's unmarried. And Jim, your name won't be there as his surviving spouse. And he's absolutely right. We hadn't thought about that. Yes, we knew Ohio wouldn't recognize our marriage. But, you know, that state amendment, that was an abstract thing. That was an abstract concept. And it was being suddenly in this moment, in this situation where here is a concrete example of the harm that that does. And it broke our hearts. And I think more importantly, it made us angry. So we discussed it. And that very day we told Al, well, he asked us if we'd be willing to consider starting a fight with the state of Ohio. And we talked about it and we said yes.
Did John have any specific words or just kind of like, yeah, let's go for it?
He told me that it was absolutely the right thing to do, and he thought we should. But as always, in our almost 21 years together, his concern was about me, not himself. And he said, you know, Jim, you have to realize this will all be on your shoulders. I can't do anything. Yes, I think it's the right thing to do, but I hope you understand it's all on you. I can't do a single thing.
From a legal standpoint, in the end, did it make any difference? Just in terms of his estate, in terms of property?
It didn't. And if I can say one slightly positive thing about ALS, you know the end is coming. You have time to plan. So we had the ability to update wills, update trusts, do other things financially and with property so that we weren't in a position where when he died, there wasn't as much concern over what would happen to everything we owned. So we were okay there. And one of the things that drove us is the fact that in John's family plot in a cemetery in Cincinnati, his grandparents bought this plot, 40s, 50s, I'm not sure when, and on the deed for the plot, they added a provision that only direct descendants and legally married spouses could be memorialized or buried on that plot. And we ran up against that issue when his mom passed away, and he went to the cemetery and said, I would like this spot for my mom, and I would like this spot for her partner of 18 years. And the cemetery said, well, I'm sorry, we can put your mom there, but we can't have him there because they're not married. We forgot about that. And it wasn't until a few weeks into the lawsuit that I think it was John, but one of us remembered that. And that was just one of those additional things. It's that thought that you mean we can't be side by side or be memorialized side by side where we'd been for 21 years. So there was very real harm, very real life things that were happening because of that amendment.
So you and Al began the work, mostly Al, of course, and he was the one who found the other people who were involved, which included two couples with kids. Suddenly we're talking about death certificates and birth certificates.
Birth to death.
During that period, were you involved beyond just you and John? Were you involved at all in the legal end of it?
I can't say I was involved in the legal end. You know, Al explained his whole concept, the whole point of our fight, our argument, and it was a really pretty easy thing to understand. And then from there, it was just conversations with us to understand what our life was like, what we had to go through, everything we had to plan for and do. And then from there, Al was really good about insulating all of the plaintiffs from the legal aspect. He kept us foremost at all times in the case. He always made sure people knew it was about real people with real problems. But he and his team, and then as the legal team grew, they handled all of the legal stuff. When they needed something from us, they would let us know. But I can't say I was really deeply involved in the legal things. And I did, you know, once he filed that second suit for the birth certificates, I was in the court hearings for those. I was involved as I could be. So it became an important thing to me to be there showing support and to be involved.
It feels as if, in Love Wins, Jim Obergefell, it feels as if you and Fatale family, the other people, all sort of became your own family.
We did, absolutely. You know, this ended up being six cases from four states, Ohio, Kentucky, Tennessee, and Michigan. And not surprisingly, because Al was our attorney, and you know, there was another widower in our case who was added. His husband died. They had gotten married a few weeks earlier, and his husband died unexpectedly. They have two or three children. He was added. Our funeral director was added, because he felt that he was at risk of, you know, being tasked as a funeral director. By law, he's supposed to fill out death certificates correctly. Well, if you're telling me to do that, but then you're saying I can't recognize this lawful marriage, you're putting me in legal jeopardy. So he was added. And then the birth certificate case, and that was three lesbian couples in Cincinnati with children, and Joe and Rob in New York who adopted in Ohio. Because it was Al, it was the same legal team, and I was able to go to the hearings, we very much became a family. As the case grew and other plaintiffs were added in the three other states, we certainly got to be friends with them. But for me, it was always that core group of the people that I was there and part of kind of from the start of their case as well.
You're listening to a 2016 interview with Jim Obergefell, co-author of Love Wins, the story of the Supreme Court fight in favor of gay marriage. I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves Artwaves Hour. In the past year, are you still friends with them? You still in touch?
Absolutely. Yeah, I had dinner with Kelly and Kelly and their beautiful daughter Ruby not too long ago. When I'm in New York, I try my best to see Joe and Rob. I actually saw them last week in New York, and their adorable son Cooper. So absolutely, we keep in touch. We did become a family.
And how about Al? Are you still in touch with him?
Absolutely. It's hard not to want to keep that man in your life. He is just one of the most intelligent, but kind and thoughtful and gentle men I've ever known. So yeah, he is still part of my life.
Love wins. Debbie Cenziper, in order to create more of, I guess, a suspense feel, doesn't really tell us up front, though it does come out, that it all boiled down to one man, Anthony Kennedy.
Mm-hmm.
You must have known that. All of you must have known that walking in.
We did. You know, after oral arguments, I tend to be a positive person, an optimistic person, and I give John credit for that. So I walked out of oral arguments honestly thinking it might be 6-3. Don't ask me why. I can't claim to be an expert in any one of those justices and anything that they asked or discussed, but I walked out thinking we might be 6-3.
Who did you think would be the other, Roberts?
No. Who did I think? Maybe it was Roberts.
Well, there's Roberts, Alito, Scalia, and Clarence Thomas.
Well, it certainly wasn't Thomas or Scalia. But no, I did. I walked out thinking that might be the result. And we all knew that no matter what, it really would probably hinge on Justice Kennedy. And he had proven in other decisions that he is a firm believer in equality for the LGBTQ community. So we did. In fact, I was even told going into the decision couple of weeks, you know, people were explaining to me how it works, and they said, you know, the Chief Justice will say, so-and-so will read a decision, and they're like, if it happens to be Kennedy, pay attention, because it's likely that it might be your case.
It's kind of every word out of his mouth, you're going, what does that mean?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, even when he was reading his decision, my first thought was, we won. And then he kept going, and I thought, well, maybe. The way they phrase things, the way they write things and explain things, I wasn't certain until about 4 or 5 sentences in that we had actually won.
You know, I'm sure that a part of you was imagining, John, was standing right next to you. What would be the expressions on his face? Would he be looking to you to figure out what was going on, or would you be looking to him to figure it out?
I would probably be looking at him, because that was our relationship. I always looked to John in pretty much every situation, social situations, anywhere we went. I liked watching John, and he was so good at being a person, being a relationship builder and social. I always looked to him. So I absolutely would have been looking at him. My guess is he might have been looking at me thinking, he always thought I was smarter for some strange reason. So I think he might have been looking at me thinking, well, Jim probably gets this better than I do. We would have been looking at each other, which is absolutely perfect.
Obergefell versus Hodges. Who is Hodges?
Hodges is the director of the Ohio State Department of Health. Okay. So the agency that's responsible for birth certificates and death certificates.
And it's weird. Now you are in history. How does that feel?
Weird, surreal. You know, it's really funny to have so frequently, especially law students and lawyers, but law students who, when I meet them, they say, I just learned about your case in con law. And there's just this excitement that they actually get to meet a named plaintiff. And I love it because it makes the case real to them. And it's something that they never expect to experience, meeting a named plaintiff. I chuckle knowing that all of these law students have to learn how to say and spell Obergefell. So it makes me laugh because I know it's not an easy name, but it's a really odd thing to think about. I really don't think it's fully sunk in just how much of a deal this is. That, I mean, I know it's a landmark case. I know it has ripple effects. I know it's important. That's on a very logical, rational level. The emotional level, I don't think, is really quite sunk in yet.
What it did do, though, is it changed your life in a lot of ways. Yes. I mean, okay, you come home from this, and I assume you're still working?
Well, in December of 2014, I got my real estate license. Up to that point, I had been in corporate training. I had done IT consulting, project management, things like that. And I wanted to change. So when John died, I traveled for some time, and then I got my real estate license. And that was December 2014. And once the Supreme Court accepted the case and then oral arguments and the decision, I had the luxury of being able to take a step back from what I was doing for a living and devote my time to the case and to the cause. And that was one of the things, you know, I felt guilty, and I still do, that it's Obergefell v. Hodges when there were 30 other plaintiffs. It isn't just about John and me. It's about so many other people. And I absolutely felt a sense of guilt that it was my name and my face getting so much attention, when their stories are just as important, just as valuable. But many of them have told me, don't think that, because we have lives that we can't step away from. We have children, we have jobs, we have things that we have to keep doing. You have the luxury of being able to do that. And you're also really good at representing us, speaking on our behalf. So for me, that was a wonderful thing to be told. And I haven't done a single thing with real estate since March of 2015.
Did you actually do any kind of work on speaking or not?
People have asked me over and over, you must have had media training. You must have taken some public speaking courses. Never. In high school, I sang. I was on stage. I did shows. College, the same thing. I was a high school German teacher. I did corporate training. So in a lot of ways, I feel like everything in my past, those things, helped create me as a person who would be comfortable speaking in front of people and speaking on behalf of others. It's just accidental.
And that began pretty much the day after the Supreme Court announcement, and hasn't stopped.
It has not stopped at all.
Jim Obergefell, getting back to Love Wins, since you worked on the manuscript and had to hone it down, what was in there and had to come out in order to tighten it up?
Well, it was trying to decide which plaintiffs to focus on, because, you know, there were so many plaintiffs. And that was one of the early things we had to decide. Who are the stories, the characters we really want to focus on? We can't write a book that covers 30 different plaintiffs, 30 different couples equally. That's just unwieldy, undoable. So that was a challenge. I would also say, you know, some of John's in my story, not that I can necessarily think of a specific example, but, you know, it talks about John and me as kids. It talks about us when we met. It talks about us when John was diagnosed. Well, there's more of our story that isn't in there. But that was a conscious decision to give more time, more coverage to other plaintiffs. So it was a balancing act to really figure out where do we focus and what can we cut.
Well, I think one of the elements that makes fiction powerful is that individual stories, even the most peculiar ones, somehow become stories for all of us, mm-hmm. even more than a general sense. So the more you focus in on the quirks of Jim and John, in some respects, the more universal it becomes.
Absolutely. And there is certainly some of that in the book. But what it comes down to is our story was all about love and loss. Every single person in this country loves someone. Every single person has lost someone they love. So at the heart of it was this story, this theme that every person can relate to. And I honestly think that is one of the reasons why over the almost 2 years of our case, I received nothing but love and support from across the country. I received 4 pieces of mail that were less than supportive in almost 2 years. That's it. And I think it was because our story, our love for each other and our fight for something that seems so obvious, an accurate death certificate, that resonated with people. And that helped along the way. And that's what really we focused on here in the story, was simply love.
I understand there's going to be a film.
There is. Yes, we actually sold the movie rights to the unfinished book before we sold the book. Temple Hill Productions is making the movie, and Fox 2000 is the studio.
Do we know any of the people who will be in it yet? Or?
Not yet. At this point, the screenwriter, Chris Weitz, who is the screenwriter for the movie About a Boy with Hugh Grant and many other things, he is currently at work on the screenplay. And Marty and Wick are the producers from Temple Hill Productions. Right now, that's pretty much the extent of the team. I think the plan is, the expectation is, when Chris finishes with the screenplay, that's likely when then the discussion will start around director and go on from there.
Yeah, one would think there are 3 main characters.
John, Jim, and Al.
Who do you want to play you?
It's just so strange to think about walking to a movie theater and seeing my life on the screen and thinking about, well, who should portray me? Honestly, for me, all I care is that whoever the actors are, I want them to bring the most life, the most passion to the characters and bring them to life. That's the most important thing. I will say, you know, people ask me this all the time, and there are lots of actors people have suggested, But my answer always is, well, okay, if you're going to push me and you want an answer, Shallow Jim will come out, and Shallow Jim will say, well, if I'm going to be on the screen, I want to be hot. So, Matt Bomer.
Jim Obergefell, you've been doing this now for a year. Mm-hmm. Has it changed your perspective, and have you had people come over to you and say, I've come out because of you?
Absolutely. That has happened to me countless times. And it's happened most frequently when I've spoken at universities. I'll have a student come up and say, Jim, I just have to tell you, you know, I just watched your and John's story, or after watching you and being here this evening, you gave me the courage to come out. And that's an incredibly powerful thing to be told, to hear that something I did or our story can have that type of an effect on a person. I love that. I mean, that is the most wonderful gift that anyone could ever give me, to know that watching John and me, watching the other plaintiffs fight for what's right, gave them the courage to take that step and to start embracing who they are and to work towards being the people they deserve to be.
And for Jim Obergefell, what lies in the future?
That's a really good question. I've decided, you know, I've been in Cincinnati for 31 years, and I've been splitting my time when I'm not traveling between Cincinnati and Washington, D.C., but I've decided I'm going to move to D.C. With everything I'm doing, advocacy work, being more politically involved, D.C. seems to be the place to be. It's also, I think about what John told me over and over and over as he was dying. He's told me, find love again, live again, don't give up, move on. And so for me, moving to D.C. is part of that. It's a chance for me to have a new adventure and in a way honor John, because he gave me the okay and he gave me the courage to do that.
Would the Jim Obergefell of 2012, looking at the Jim Obergefell of 2016, be astonished?
Astounded. And from the simplest perspective, when John and I would go to social events and it'd be a big gathering or whatever, I always held back and let John do that because that was his skill. He was so good at that. And I loved watching him meet people, build those relationships. And I admit I was lazy. I let him take that role. The fact that I now walk into rooms full of people I've never met, know nothing about, and the fact that I'm comfortable doing that and I can do that really because of what I saw John do, I think that is what would astonish Jim of 2012 more than anything.
You've been listening to an interview with Jim Obergefell, who is the co-author, along with Debbie Cenziper, of Love Wins, The Lovers and Lawyers Who Fought the Landmark Case for Marriage Equality. If you'd like to hear extended versions of the interviews heard on the Bookwaves Artwaves Hour, please check out the Radio Wolinsky and Bay Area Theater podcasts in the Area 941 section of kpfa.org. You can find even more interviews if you go to my website, bookwaves.com. Until next week, I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves Artwaves Hour.
Hey, don't trade it for peanuts. Donate your old car to KPFA and get the full tax write-off. Vehicle donations are a win-win for everyone. They're the perfect way to support KPFA. Put your unwanted car, boat, motorhome, or truck to good use. It's easier than selling it, and you'll get a tax receipt for your records. Donating your vehicle to KPFA is really easy, and it only takes 3 steps.
1.
Have your VIN number and the title to your car handy. Call the Car Donation Center at 877-411-3662 or fill out the Donate Now form online at kpfa.org to schedule a convenient time to pick up your vehicle.
3.
Give the tow truck driver your signed title and, of course, the keys. And that's it. When your vehicle sells, you'll receive a thank you letter and an IRS tax form 1098. Thank you for supporting community-powered KPFA.
Hey, are you a KPFA member who wants to vote in the ongoing Pacifica Bylaws referendum but have not received your electronic ballot by email? If so, please go to elections.pacifica.org and fill out a ballot request form, or call and leave a message for the election supervisor with your name, home address, email, and phone number at 510-993-0320. The deadline to request paper ballots is June 25th, and the deadline to request electronic ballots is July 6th. All votes must be received before 11:59 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on July 7th. For more information on the bylaws referendum positions, please find the 2021 Bylaws Voter Guide at elections.pacifica.org. It's 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K24 ABR in Santa Cruz, and on.